Welcome again and good evening. This is truly a great moment because it brings together great minds in this church, great minds that are being presented with this issue and also the occasion, 60 years of regional conference work. How did we come about? Why are we here? What is our purpose? And who better to tell us about that before we talk about who we have than our own president, Elder Willie Taylor.
Mark, and good afternoon, everyone. Good afternoon to the television and audience. We are very, very pleased that Southeastern Conference is able to bring such a distinguished group of individuals together on behalf of the 60th anniversary of regional conferences. Many individuals do not know very much about the inception and the contributions of regional conferences. And we thought that it would be a golden opportunity to just sit and chat with individuals, many of whom lived the experience, made the contributions that we stand on today, as well as those of us who can look back and gather in like a link in the chain to carry the banner forward. We're not here this afternoon to discuss whether or not we should or should not do anything, but we are here to say thank you, Jesus, for your leadership, for giving us committed and loyal members, and for helping us out in our evangelism thrust, and for just looking back on 60 golden years of development. And hopefully, many of you will understand where we came from and why. And you can participate better in where we are going. Praise God. Thank you very much.
They say that you don't know where you're going unless you know where you've come from. And I thought I would tell you who we have so that there is authority in what you hear. We'll start with our own president, Elder Willie Taylor, a product of Florida. And grown, bred, in fact, as a young man, he ran around these camp meeting grounds. And time has been good. The Lord has seen fit to place him in his place where he leads us now. Elder Taylor is the one who's made this moment possible, and I want to thank you in front of everybody else. Next, of course, is no stranger to those who understand good preaching. Those who know a man with conviction. Those who know about a man who speaks his mind. Elder Joseph McCoy, until recently, was president of South Central Conference. Can I hear somebody say amen out there? Amen. And not only has he now done that, but he's moved on. And he is now director of the retirement program in the North American Division for regional conferences. And he will talk numbers. But well, before we get there, I want to tell you about somebody else who was also just recently a president of this time, Lake Region Conference. Dr. Norman Mylas, before he became what he is now, meaning senior pastor at Hyde Park Church, was president of Lake Region Conference. He was also a professor at Andrews Theological Seminary, or shall we say, the Seventh-day Theological Seminary at Andrews University. And in addition to that, he was adjunct professor at University of Michigan. So he understands a little bit about history. Besides, his PhD is in history. So he can tell us a few things about history. Now, do I even need to tell you about the next person? You know, those of you who were here today heard him preach. Now, come on now, you sound like you weren't even here. All right now. You know, I have a phrase that Dr. Charles D. Brooks uses. He says, sin is a progression of excesses. And he has these nice, informative, deeply meaningful witticisms that he sprinkles in all he says. He is not just a preacher, an evangelist. What's unique about him is that where most pastors are pastors and not quite evangelists, he has been able to marry evangelism and pastoring. A rarity. So that when he speaks, God is speaking. Now, come on, y'all. There you go. Now you're looking at the gentleman sitting next to him and wondering, who is this? This is Mr. Mylas Martin. Mr. Martin, in addition to many things he has done, he's a former journalist. He is also the former dean of men at Oakwood College. Now, wait a minute. I thought there'd be people from Oakwood here who might say amen. Amen. All right now. And this is the part that I like so much about it. Now, he is a man with his own opinions, strong opinions, but they are founded on fact. He has lived the struggle to get the church to do the things it needs to do. All right now. So he can speak to how we've come to this point, because he goes back 60 years in his involvement with this church. Amen. Involvement at the leadership level. So we are glad to have you, Brother Mylas Martin. Now, what does one say about Dr. E.E. Cleveland? You know, there was a French existentialist who said, I am, therefore I am, and I'm using my own language. Elder Cleveland is there because he is. He is the dean of evangelists. In fact, the reason why people have now become good evangelists is because Dr. Cleveland taught them. In addition to baptizing, we don't need to say thousands because we've run out of the numbers. I think he's preached on almost every continent with the possible exception of Antarctica. And then I'm not even sure whether you don't have converts who are there.
I was born in Alabama. So Antarctica. I was born.
Yes, sir.
Born in Alabama.
Yes.
Therefore, Antarctica did not pose a tempting territory.
There you go. So there you have it. Men justified by God, strengthened by his love, and convicted by the training he has provided. These are the men who are going to walk us through this process. The first part, and what we're trying to do, as Elder Taylor said, is not to revise history, not to make anybody uncomfortable, but to explain so that the constituents of Southeastern Conference and the world beyond will understand how regional conferences came to be. Why are they there? Why are they accomplishing? And to start us off will be Dr. Norman Miles, because as we said, he's the historian on the ground, who will walk us through the beginning. We will start way back. I mean, way, way back in 1838. Dr. Miles. Yes, sir. Absolutely.
Dr. Miles and I have agreed to exchange topics. And so.
So then it is Mr. Mylas Martin. Go ahead.
Thank you. It will surprise many of you to know two or three things about this church and the church organization. Immediately after the disappointment in 1844, for the next 18 years, those who eventually became Seventh-day Adventists fought over the issue of should they organize. There were many people who thought we should not formally organize into another church. So it took Dr. Miles until 1863, before we had a Seventh-day Adventist church. But long before we had a Seventh-day Adventist church, there were black Americans who were in the Millerite movement and who were among the first Adventists. For example, in New England, there were black Americans who were part of the Millerite movement, and they, interestingly enough, were middle class. They were middle class black Americans. Now, but it is true also that Mrs. White, Ellen G. White, in 1859, traveled to Michigan, which was then the American frontier, and at Warren, Michigan, she spent the night with a family. I believe they were the Harveys. I may be mistaken about that. But she several times had been a guest there. And in one letter that she wrote, she complimented the mother of the three or four children. She said how intelligent her children were, how well-mannered they were. That was a black American family. in the Adventist church in the very beginning, because they had religious fervor and because they were small in number, they were welded together, so there were no distinctions made. I'd like you to know that as we begin. Now, will someone talk about J. Edson White? Will you, Dr. Miles?
Sure, I'd be glad
before
to.
Before you do that, yes. We have someone also talk about William Foy, so that we kind of have a sense of what our involvement in the church was about.
William Foy.
Who was he anyway?
Was a New England, he was a black, was described as a mulatto preacher, a congregationalist preacher who was involved in the Millerite movement. And he was given some visions just before the Great Disappointment in 1844. He'd been a Millerite preacher for some 6 or 7 years before the Great Disappointment. But shortly before the Great Disappointment, he was given a series of visions. Three of those visions he not only preached, but he published in a pamphlet, and it had wide distribution. There was a fourth vision, however, that was very troublesome to him. He said it became to him a great crossing. I remember when I was a child, we used to hear that he said his color became his cross. That was not true. He said that it became him a great crossing. Here was the problem. The first three visions seemed to be talking about the Jesus coming, and all of a sudden, this fourth vision was a vision that indicated some time after 1844. Now, he had a real problem. He believed that the principles of the Bible were true and that his time calculations were right. If that was true, then his vision was wrong because Jesus was going to come in 1844. However, if he believed that the visions were true, then he had a real problem. And he could not reconcile the difference between his visions and his Bible calculations. And so he did not preach nor publish the fourth vision. After the Great Disappointment in a meeting
from here.
Sometime later, Ellen White recited these same three visions and the fourth one. And he said that he got up in the meeting and shouted that was the vision that he saw. And later on, Ellen White did record in her diary that they were shown identical visions. And so, in fact, William Foy was given this message to preach. And he did it rather faithfully. That fourth message, he could not understand. As a child, I was often made to feel that, well, you know, this poor black man, what would have happened if he had gone on and preached that faithfully? Well, nothing different probably would have happened because he died in 1851 before the Seventh-day Adventist Church was organized. He was a much older man than Ellen White. But it is significant to note that during that period of time, God was reaching out to whomever would listen to him, including African Americans. Now, you've asked me to speak about the whole issue of what was happening not William Foy. James Edson White. James Edson White came along much later. And I think we need to recognize James Edson White's mission for what it really turned out to be. Right after the Civil War, there were over 7.5 million freed men, that is, people who were former slaves, who were in the South. They were free, but that was about it. They had no education, they had no money, they had no land, they had no rights. They were just free. They were free to move about if they could afford to or if they could find a way to make a living. Every church in the North began to go down and began to educate these people. In fact, between 1867 and 1877, over 5,000 churches and schools were established in the South for African Americans. Almost every building that could be utilized was utilized for the purpose of teaching blacks how to read and teaching them the Bible. And Ellen White urged in 1867, she made an appeal at the General Conference session and urged us to get involved in this working for freedmen. But at that time, the leadership of the church was interested in a missionary impulse to some people that they knew something about, and that is people who were in Europe. You have to remember that many of the early leaders of the Adventist church were first generation American immigrants. They had relatives, grandparents, and parents, and cousins and uncles who were still living in the old country. And so the first Adventist missionary turned out to be J.N. Andrews, who was sent to Europe to evangelize that area. So for years, the work among blacks in the South languished, with one or two exceptions. You had C.M. Kinney and a few others who established some churches, but there was no real missionary push until James Edson White, who was Ellen and James White's son, became convicted that this was something that needed to be done. Collected money, had a boat built called the Morning Star, floated it down the Mississippi River, and began to stop at ports of call in various Mississippi River towns and teach people the gospel, taught people how to read, taught them how to farm and how to plant crops that were...
Now, this was significant, if I may interrupt, wasn't
yes.
it? It was significant in that they were not just preaching, teaching the gospel.
No.
They were helping people to become self-sufficient.
Exactly, and that's one of the things that got him in a lot of trouble down
there.
Yeah,
and go ahead. I mean, I was wanting to get that point in.
Sure. One of the things that got James Edson White and early Adventist missionaries to the South at that time in lots of trouble was that they were teaching black folks how to raise something other than cotton, how to raise subsistence crops so that they could eat, and training them in health methods and so forth. And what was beginning to happen is that they were becoming Sabbath keepers. Right. They were not working on the plantations anymore. They were able to raise their own food.
Why was that a problem?
Well, that was a threat to the economic basis of the South.
Because they worked on Saturday, didn't they?
Because in the South, everybody worked 5 days a week and half day on Saturday.
There's something interesting.
Yes, sir.
Right in there that I think should be noted. Mrs. White, knowing that her son was headed south, went into prayer for her son, Edson. And the Lord revealed to her some instructions that she was supposed to give to Edson as he traveled south so that he would stay out of trouble with the white folks, you know? So it gets interesting because... these instructions were supposed to be in the on the shelves in the Review and Herald office,
right.
Where Uriah Smith, who wrote Daniel in the Revelation, controlled. And Uriah was not converted too much on the black-white question. Mm. So these documents were all up there, carelessly distributed in the building. Nobody knew what they were. And a painter was over there painting, and the stuff up there was thrown out and put in the trash can in the back, the writings of the prophet. Mm. And the poor painter didn't know what he was doing. He just, you know.
Painted.
But we're indebted to Jacob Justice for this research.
Wow.
He says that when Edson came just in time to try to get the info, because his mother had told him, I've written about how you ought to work wisely in the South. Mm. And he was fumbling around. Finally, the man told him, said, there's some stuff out there getting ready to be burned, you know. And he recaptured that. And my friend Mylas Martin and Frank Hale resurrected that book.
Yes.
It's called The Southern Work, you know?
Yes.
And in it, some of the purest statements on the humanity of all men.
Yes.
Are found in that little book.
In fact, I like this. Here's what I want, because this is the part now that gets interesting, because we now have in our midst people who are actually involved in doing something about preserving our truth.
Yeah, that's right.
We got them sitting right here.
Yeah.
But before you speak, I have a nice young lady who's going to sing a song, set the mood, and then we're going to talk about what you did.
And don't be too modest.
This is Yukika Simo from Mount Pisgah. Please join me in saying amen to her. Amen.
Good afternoon, all. Good afternoon, all.
Good afternoon.
I think you can do a little better than that. A little song that I'm going to share with you this evening, entitled Nobody's Fault But Mine. I'm going to give you my rendition of it, a little shorter version, but just my perspective. So I may need your help. So if I say put your hands together, please don't be afraid to. Just listen to the words of the song and allow the Holy Spirit to convict your heart. It's nobody's fault but mine. Nobody's fault but mine. And if I die and my soul is lost, say that it's nobody's fault but mine. I've got a Bible, I can read it if I choose. I got a Bible, I can read it if I choose. But if I die and my soul is lost, it's nobody's fault but mine. I got to niche it, I can pray if I choose. I got to knees that I can pray if I choose. But if I die and my soul is lost, say that it's nobody's fault but mine. Say that it's nobody's fault but mine. Put your hands together, help me sing it. Nobody's fault but mine. But if I and my soul is lost, it's nobody's fault but mine. You got it. One more time. Hear me out. Nobody's fault but mine. Nobody's fault but mine. And if I die and my soul is lost, say that it's nobody's.
Amen. Amen.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ellen G. White had some feelings on a very important topic. She wrote it out in longhand. She titled it Our Duty to the Colored People. And she read it to the General Conference Executive Committee in session when the Michigan Conference and the GC were meeting simultaneously. And I will tell you at another time about a man whose name was Robert Meade Kilgore. But as a result, and he was the superintendent of the Southern Division, District 2, and as a result of his policies, Mrs. White wrote Our Duty to the Colored People, and she followed that with several other articles, most of them published in the Adventist, what was then the Review and Herald. Her son, James Edson White, was 44 years old before he found himself. He was converted, and he decided that he would work for the colored people in the South. He built this boat with his wife, Emma, and eight others. They sailed down the Mississippi River to Vicksburg, and that's where they began preaching and teaching. Now, the brethren were not happy, Elder Brooks, with Mrs. White for what she wrote, and they invited her to go to Australia for 10 years. I say invited.
Now I want you to say that one more time.
They invited Ellen G. White to go to Australia for 10 years. And from Australia, she wrote to James Edson White and helped him to see how he might labor to gain souls in Mississippi. And she had he had quite a time because they burned down the school once. In 1900, in Yazoo, Mississippi, two editorials were written in both newspapers, and what they said about Seventh-day Adventists and people who were trying to convert others to keep the seventh-day Sabbath when everyone knew that Sunday was the right day, that's what they said. They were quite upset. But James Edson White persevered. Now, what he did was to put together our duty to the colored people with all the other things he had written about race, and he published them in this little book called The Southern Work, and he gave it that title, but she wrote everything in it. Now, what happened was this. From 1900 to 1910, there was a severe, prolonged animus bias against black Americans. Mrs. White at that time was writing Volume 9, Elder Brooks.
Yeah.
And the church already had the Southern Work. It was widely distributed, so the church knew her views on race. And by the way, may I see the hands of you who have ever gotten a copy of the Southern Work? Many. Those of you who don't have it, you need to go to your Adventist bookstore and get it. But now, the entire church understood that what she was saying in Volume 9 was to be understood in the context of what she'd written before.
Absolutely.
Now, because of that severe reaction against black people, Mrs. White finally said in Volume 9, until the Lord shows us a better way, it is best that the colored people have their own churches. But now it was an exigency.
Yes.
It was an expedient meant for a given time.
Right.
Everyone understood that, but some did not understand. You know the name Lottie Cornelia Blake, one of the first women Adventist physicians. She graduated from Battle Creek in 1902. Her aunt graduated. Her name was Kimbrough. They lived in Dr. Kellogg's house. They were students of Kellogg, and they were two of the first black American Adventist physicians. But now, what happened was this. Mrs. White did say that in Volume 9. Mrs. White died in what year, sir? 1915. The Southern Work was widely distributed all over the denomination, and it was printed at Oakwood College. But within 5 years, Elder Taylor, you could not find a copy of the Southern Work. And between 1920 and 1962, it was lost. It was so lost that the president of the General Conference in 1962 had not read it, he'd never heard of it. The book was not even listed in the index to her writings. And might I suggest that that was not an accident?
Yeah.
I said to Elder Theodore Karsich and Elder Neil Wilson, our mutual friend, when I put it all together, I called and I said, I'm coming down. And I walked into a meeting with those two men and I said, now we understand. You have deliberately taken this out of publication so that all of us would believe that Mrs. White's last word on matters racial was in Volume 9.
That's right.
The entire church believed that. I saw a copy of the Southern Work for the first time because Frank Hale, my great good friend, showed me a copy that had belonged to Elder Green.
Now we need to say who Dr. Frank Hale is.
He's a former president of Oakwood College. He's been provost and associate dean at Ohio State University. And he has secured more than $22 million in scholarships for black students for grad school to get their doctorates and masters. And a fair number of them have been Oakwood College students.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
He has been a great leader, a great lay leader in this church.
Yes.
Dr. Hale, on February 26, 1961, showed me his copy of Elder Green's copy of the Southern Work. He had gotten, his Elder Green's wife had given it to him. I took that home. I sat up all night. I read it through, straight through, three times. And I said to myself, this book must be republished. I made that a goal. The Layman's Leadership Conference, which Dr. Hale and I had formed, and he and I became co-chairman. We adopted that as one of our goals. And we did that simply because it was so necessary for the entire world to know what Mrs. White really said about race relations, not just in this church, but in this country. We asked the denomination to reprint it. The denomination said no. We continued to ask, and they continued to say no. I have a letter in my files, Elder McCoy. I didn't know it was there. It was from Mrs. White's grandson, Arthur White. And he is saying to me, wait, we're still studying this matter. I would suggest, Elder McCoy, that Elder Cleveland's letters, I have some of his. These are things that need to be preserved for our people in archives. I have some letters from F.D. Nickel that are still smoking. Those old men. Now I'm one of them.
Now, I don't want to stop you here, but I want to sort of go back a little bit so that we explain contextually how we get to 1960 and the General Conference session where you went, because I feel it's important so that folks get a sense that we had blacks being evangelized initially, Elder Taylor, in the rural areas because they worked in the plantation. Then what happened, Dr. Miles, because they started going to urban areas, did they not?
Exactly. You had, in this country, you had two large migratory movements, actually several, but you had one that began around 1900, between about 1890 and 1910, which W.E.B. Du Bois dubbed the migration of the talented 10th. It was a migration primarily of people who lived in southern cities. Usually these were better educated blacks, people who were teachers, people who had professions or skilled tradesmen, who were moving from cities like Atlanta, Nashville, and so forth, to cities like New York, Detroit, Chicago. And then right around
In fact, if I may interrupt, yes. Brother Martin's family hails from
Alabama.
So we have two Alabama boys right here. And your family moved to Cleveland.
Yes.
And this was the same pattern that subsequently happened that you're now speaking to.
And it really began to pick up around between 1915 and 1922.
Right.
You had what they call the Great Migration, when you had a large number now of, as a result of World War I and the need for more black workers in factories and so forth, or more workers, period, in factories. And European immigration was cut off because for a long time in northern cities, workers came from Europe. But when World War I began, no European immigration is coming over, but they still need factory output. In fact, it increases as the United States gets involved in the war. And so now you've got these calls for hundreds of thousands of black people who left the South from farms, plantations, everywhere, and came to cities like New York, Chicago, Detroit, Cleveland, you name it. And they usually followed the trunk lines, so that people from Florida and Georgia often went to New York, New Jersey, and those places. People from North Carolina sometimes often went to New York as well, and Washington, D.C., in those areas. A lot of people from Tennessee and Alabama went to Detroit and Cleveland. People from Louisiana and Mississippi usually went straight on up to Chicago. They usually followed the railroad lines. And now we had a unique challenge, because you had all these hundreds of thousands of black people coming into cities at one time. And these people needed to be evangelized. And in fact, almost one of the real things that happened as a result of the migration is that the churches that existed in cities, the Baptist and the Methodist churches and so forth, almost all of them exploded in growth overnight, just because you got all these people coming into cities. And it represented a real opportunity now for black people to be evangelized in a way that James Edson White could not, because he was dealing with people scattered out all over the South.
Which brings us back to Mr. Martin now.
Yes, well,
because you got
Elder
there
Brooks.
When you were four, is it my understanding?
Yes,
that?
That's true.
Right.
But now, Elder Brooks, you not only were at Oakwood College with me, you were a sophomore, 18, and I was a freshman, 17.
I thought we were the same age.
Oh, no. Oh, no. You're older, sir. He's lots older. He's 11 months older than I am. Elder C.D. Brooks, not only were we schoolmates at Oakwood College, but you became my pastor in 1960. Is that right?
That's right, 1960.
Now
where was this? In Cleveland?
In Cleveland,
all
Ohio.
Right, all right.
Now, that's important to know because Elder Brooks had a part to play in this, and I want him to tell his part that he played after I point out three things to you. Number one, most of us believe that we have never been engaged in the civil rights struggle. That's false.
False.
Now you gotta say that one more time so that they can truly hear it.
That is false.
Yes, sir.
As a matter of fact, the first internal civil rights struggle in the Adventist Church involved Oakwood College when there was a strike. Jacob Justice tells about that too, Elder. And one of these days, we'll get Jacob Justice out in the shape that he deserves to have. But it was a strike that brought the first black president.
Now, what is the strike about?
Well, Oakwood was supposed to become a college, and the students said they were doing more manual labor than anything else. They said they were being trained to be servants.
I'm getting a sense that we had other students who were there about the time.
Well, let me give you some names.
Yes. Oh, so you have two strikes.
Oh, yes. Now, in the first strike, W.W. Fordham, Samuel Rashford, Monroe Burgess, Herman Murphy, Frank Bland, all of these became leading preachers and administrators in the church or leading laymen. But they were 16, 17, 18 years old when the first civil rights movement among black Adventists began at Oakwood College. Now, the second one, would you tell us about it, Elder McCoy, the second strike?
Well, actually, there was an attempt to integrate the white church in Huntsville, Alabama.
What year, sir?
This is 1963 or 4, I'm not exactly sure. But back in those days, was it 64? And we were not interested in going to church there. But two of our teachers, just for a change of pace, decided to go down to worship at the church in the city, and they were turned away. Well, we wouldn't sit still for that because they offended two of our very nice teachers, and we descended on that church the next couple of weeks like a dark cloud to make sure that they understood that there was not a Seventh-day Adventist church on the planet into which we could not go.
Now, what was happening in the country at that time?
Well, this is the, you know, the civil rights movement. There's a lot of demonstrations going on. Martin Luther King was in his heyday. Oakwood, of course, is in Alabama, and a lot rebellious activity came out of your state and Elder Cleveland's state. I just want everybody.
Selma had happened.
Yes. So we went down there, and there were some interesting reactions from the members who stopped us in the lobby of the church, and we began to sing spirituals. And the report came out of that congregation that we were singing rock and roll music in the lobby of the church. We refused to leave, and they finally let us go in and sit down because they found out we were not going to leave. There were some brothers out of one brother in particular from Washington, D.C. area that we had to pray for because he was known to have a very short fuse, and we didn't want him to disturb the pews. But we were able to kind of keep him under tow. But long story short, after several meetings with the students, in fact, the word came down from the General Conference to the faculty that they should not participate in giving us rides down to the church. When they called the police, we called the television and newspaper so that we would have somebody to witness what was going to take place. And finally, when they discovered that we were determined not to be turned away from that church, they agreed for us to have some conversation, dialogue as to how we could integrate the church. We let them know we were not interested in integrating the church. We just didn't want to be rebuffed when any of our people, students or faculty, decided to go down. We had problems when the word came down from General Conference not to ferry the students down to the church. Well, some of us were, how should I say, knowledgeable enough to know that there was an NAACP in the city. And they sent cars out to the campus for us, which were better than the faculty members' cars, and took us down to the church to make sure that the members understood that they couldn't keep us out of that church.
Now, Elder McCoy, let's fast forward just a bit. At Andrews University, you and Alvin Kibble were there, and one night something happened. I ask Elder McCoy to tell you this simply because this is the point we wish to make. We've come a long way in this country, but it has been, what are the words, stony the road we trod.
Bitter the chastening rod.
It was not different in the church from what was happening in the larger society. It was not different. And that's what you need to keep in mind. What happened one night, Elder McCoy, when you were in the seminary at Andrews, and what year was this?
Well, this is 1968 and 1969, and there were many nights, I must confess, that things were going on the campus because we were trying to press for a Black History Day, really, or Black History Week. And there was resistance on the part of the university to our having it. And we insisted that that should happen. There were some Confederate flags in the dormitories, and there was a cross burned on the campus at Andrews. And
can you imagine this? You wake up in the middle of the night, and here is a huge fiery cross. And it was right behind the girls' dormitory, as I understand.
Correct. And of course, some of the being ministerial students, some of us wanted to go and stand around the burning cross and pray. I was not interested in going to stand around the cross to pray. Somebody said prayer is all right at prayer meeting. It's not worth much at bear meeting. So we, it's a slow group in here. But we were determined that we were going to have the Black History Celebration. And finally, the faculty relented and asked us, what shall we do? There was another incident that took place there. We had Louis Lomax to come out of Los Angeles, a television, who had a television program in Los Angeles, and he actually did light the fire that caused a reaction from the larger community about Black history commemorative events.
Now, I want to get us back to this again center. Because I like where we're going, and I get the sense here that there are strands of experiences about the effect the civil rights movement had.
What we're trying to show, Mark.
I want to hear first from somebody like Willie Taylor, and then I want to hear from Elder Cleveland. But before we do that, I want to go back to music because I want to get this thing in context. What we're trying to do, what you said?
Oh? I thought we were discussing the Southern work.
Yes.
And have we left that?
No, we have not. And that's why I want to get back to that, because I think we are now in the civil rights period. I kind of want to get back to the Southern work so that contextually people will understand how the regional conferences came about. We have to, if you just bear with me for a second, we need to get this in context so that we do that. But before we do that, I am asking Kimberly Skinner from Mount Calvary Seventh-day Adventist Church to come and bless us with a song, and we can get ourselves together again and then deal with this issue, because I think it's paramount to the issue. And I seriously think we haven't heard from the man from Alabama who has an experience to tell that we haven't heard from.
We serve a worthy God, right? Yeah. Amen. He's due all our praise. Hallelujah. God is so good. He's always waiting for us to just ask what we need. And if we will just realize that we have so much power, we just come to God in prayer, He's always willing to give us the things that we are lacking. He's so worthy. And for this, we want to just give Him some praise. So many wonderful blessings and so many open doors, a brand new mercy along with each new day. And that's why I praise you. And for this, I give you praise. For waking me up this morning, for starting me on my way.
Thank you, Sister Kim Skinner.
Mr. August, we've
Thank
not
so
yet
much.
Heard from Elder Brooks.
Let me just get back to the context. Here's what I want to make sure we are all on the same page. We started by talking about where the process started. Then we started to talk about the movement of people into the urban areas. Remember now, what we're trying to explain is how regional conferences came about. We have to explain the process and the tensions that happened when people got into these urban areas so that people will know what caused the need for the regional conferences. So, having said that, let me say this. I want to hear from Elder Cleveland so that I get perspectives from everybody, and then Elder Brooks, because I want to get a sense here about what the challenges were for the people who got into these urban areas, areas that had not been evangelized, people who didn't have a relationship with God, at least as we wanted them to have it, and how the Seventh-day Adventist Church went about or failed to meet that challenge. Elder Brooks. Yes, sir.
You caught me by surprise.
I apologize.
Yeah, it's all right.
What was it like to be a young pastor in the denomination in those days?
Oh, then we start at a later date. When these issues were fermenting, I was rather new in the church. Yes. And knew very little about all of this that we're discussing now.
Right.
I had to learn about it much, much later. I remember when I graduated from college, my father-in-law, who was the first president of the Allegheny Conference, was making a presentation to the Union Committee concerning integrating Columbia Union College, which was then Washington Missionary College. He had gone to a great deal of trouble getting graphs and artistic things made, and he told us about his plans and the presentation. When he returned, he said little about it. And I went one day to his office and knocked on the door, and I wanted to know what was the result of the presentation. And he simply said under his breath, "They turned us down." I admit to you that I got terribly exercised about it. Perhaps enthusiastically, I objected to what I was hearing and suggested to him, this great leader, that we don't need these folk. Maybe we ought to pull out and do something on our own. And I wanted to tell this. While I was talking and carrying on, he pushed his chair back, opened a drawer, and took out an old dog-eaten copy of the Southern Work. Mm. And he began to read to me. Now, you who have not read it ought to know everything in it is not complimentary. But our chairman has been talking about the context of the time. Ellen White spoke to the issues that were then. And yet she spoke to moral principles which are now. And as he read this to me, I'll be honest with you, folk, it was as though heaven opened and light came down. I said to him, "Sir, what is that you're reading?" And he showed me. "Who wrote it?" And he showed me. "Where has it been?" He said, "They stopped publishing it." And then he leaned back in his chair and he said, "Son, I want to tell you two things. Folks, I want to tell you two things." Just what he told me. He said, "There are two things. Number one, the message we've been called to preach is the truth."
Yes.
He said, "Now don't you ever forget that." You notice I haven't forgotten. Secondly, he said, "This is the true church. In it, we've got racists and liars and adulterers and all kinds of people, but this is the true church. And don't you ever forget it." I thank God for that. Mr. Martin was about to talk about a little part I played in getting the Southern Work redone. He and Frank Hale did the big work. But he had everybody nervous in Washington, and by this time, I am associate leader of the Human Relations Department of the Columbia Union. And we had a meeting coming up, and I got in touch with my friend and said, "I want to come to visit you in New York." And I didn't tell him why, and so we got there, and to be honest with you, we just had a good time. And when I was getting ready to go, I said to him, "We're having a meeting on Tuesday of the Human Relations Department, and I'm the chairman. And I want you to write me a letter, the toughest letter you ever wrote before. And I want you to outline the things that you and the group will need in order to meet the next General Conference session in peace." He said, "I'll do it." On Monday, I got that letter. On Tuesday, I walked into the committee, and with feigned concern, I said, "Brethren, I just heard from Mylas Mott." And I got everybody's attention. He said, and I said, "Wait a minute, the letter's in my pocket. You want me to read it?" "Why, yes." And I took it out and I read it slowly and with much emphasis. When I finished reading it, someone said to me, "Does Elder Wilson have a copy of this?" I said, "Do you think he should have?" "Why, yes." The copy was already addressed, by the way. And then they said, "Elder Figueroa, the president of the General Conference, should have it." "You think so?" And we sent it. We sent one to Elder Cleveland. All of these letters were made. On Thursday, I got a call from the president of the Columbia Union. He said, "Charles, get in touch with Martin. Tell him the president is enthusiastic about having the Southern work republished. In fact, he acts like it was his own idea." Mr. Martin and I have concluded, charitably, that our president had not read the Southern work, because his attitude changed. It was very apparent. And I began to wonder what's come over him. And when he retired, we were driving up the hill to the college at Pacific Union College, and he was in his yard, and we stopped just to say hello. What a warm man he was. It'll happen to you when you read what inspiration has to say about the brotherhood of man. And when you dare to believe it, you overcome your problems. Reverse discrimination is as bad as the other kind. What we've been trying to do up here, what our brethren have been trying to do, is show that we have always been a part of this church and we're not going anywhere. Amen. We are here to stay. Oh, you say, "But we've had to take some things." That develops character.
Yes, sir.
That's very good.
Yes, sir. Now, Mr. Martin, going back, how long had the book at that time been out of print?
It was from 1920, and actually, it was not published by the church. We published it in 1962. My goal always was to have the denomination publish it, and I wanted it to go back in the index to her writings. That did not happen until 1966, and I must be honest with you, I knew that a movement was afoot to keep it from being republished, and I knew that it was the very thing we all needed. We all needed it. And so one day I walked into the office of Elder Theodore Karsich, who was a vice president of the GC. Elder Wilson was there. And Elder Karsich is gone now. Elder Wilson is still alive. I hope he hears this, because I want to tell it as it happened. Elder Karsich said to me, "We are not going to republish it." And I said to Elder Karsich, and I have forgotten to tell you that I was a journalist, I was a newspaper man, the 1966 General Conference in Detroit was coming up. And I said, "Well, Elder Karsich, if you won't republish it, then I have no choice. In Detroit in 1966 at the General Conference session, I will have Martin Luther King Jr. standing in public reading the Southern work word for word," and they knew I could do it.
Amen. 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 How soon did they respond?
Oh, immediately. We struck a bargain. They would republish it, and I would go to Europe instead of going to Detroit.
Well, there are nicer ways of getting to Europe. I'm glad you didn't go. Now, I want to sort of go back, if I may, because I think what you've touched on now ties in very well. You've had that migration of people to the urban areas at this time. What are the challenges happening
in this society, and how are they affecting what's happening in the church? I think you touched on it, but this is why I want to ask Elder Cleveland now, because we are now getting to that moment where things have to happen, because there are things happening in the society, and the church has to deal with it. Elder Cleveland.
Well, the thing started happening a long time ago.
Talk to me.
There's an old Negro by the name of Kenny who started the problem that dealing with the problem that we are dealing with now.
Yes.
It's not as complicated as it might seem. You see, Kenny joined the church, a black man, and discovered that they were the blacks who he brought to the church were being offended by the Caucasian whites who were already in the church. Now you're back at the genesis now.
Yes.
Of how all of this civil rights stuff got started.
Yes.
Old C.M. Kinney.
Yes.
When his proposition that we all meet together and go to heaven together from down here was rebuffed, he said, then we want camp meetings of our own. Hmm. Now, this is where the action started with old C.M. Kinney.
Yeah.
We lost several of the greatest black preachers in the history of the world to this initiative. Nunes, Charles Manns, John, I rebaptized Charles Manns back into the Seventh-day Adventist Church,
Man.
By the way.
Yeah.
Humphrey, great preacher. These and others, John, well, no, those are the ones we lost. it is interesting that what these men wanted was regional conferences. I've been itching to get here. They wanted what some of you don't understand right now. Why aren't we all together? Now, this panel is here not only to tell you about history, but to tell you why we are not all together. And to discuss the legitimacy of our present posture in terms of Christianity. Now, that's what's on your mind, and I'm going to help you with it. Now, these men that I named were B.C., you know, you got B.C. and A.D. They were B.C. before Cleveland. Okay? All right. So I can claim no credit. Listen to me, honey, and I'll tell you why I want you to listen to me. I'm the first black man that wrote a book that got published by the Review and Herald on race. It was called The Middle Wall. I am not trying to disturb you. I'm trying to give you a little understanding, and I hope these men will grab it and keep it going. This thing, we lost some of the greatest preachers in the history of the world over whether or not we should have regional conferences. And they went out of the church, and as I tell you, when I came to Gainesville to preach, I baptized one of them back, old Charles Mann. He came to my meeting. Is that right, folks? He came to my meetings every night, and baptism time came. It was funny. He was sitting on the porch. I went around there. I said, Brother Charlie. He said, yeah. You've been out there every night. I think you're on the way back. He said, why do you think that? I said, why did you all leave? And then I answered my own question. Because of regional conferences, the church denied you the privilege of establishing regional conferences. He said, that's right, son. I said, what's keeping you out now? We got them. Next Sabbath, he went down in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. Now, I've got one more quick thing I want to say to you. Before I turn to you. As you notice, I've been just sitting here listening. But there's a heap in my head. Let me tell you that when regional conferences were established, Fordham, Wagner, all of these men were the ones that were party to the proposition that we set up our own conferences in the light of our being unwelcome at the other meetings run by white people. Now, the legitimacy of that is this. The church, like few other institutions in America, is a voluntary organization. Amen. You'd better believe it. A man can belong to any church that suits his worship style. If he wants to belong to a church that would not pose the danger of the daughter, white, marrying a black man, black, that's their privilege. There are black folk that you don't want your daughter to marry. Now, wait, we got to get rid of some stuff in here. I didn't come down here to play with you.
Yes, sir. Talk, preacher.
Let's get to the problem. White people have a right to worship anywhere they want to.
Yes, sir.
What Mrs. White did for us with these brothers who published the Southern work was to let you know that you should not object if somebody of another race wants to join your church. Freedom of worship. When I went to Washington in 1954, I was elected up there. I stayed 23 years, longer than any Negro in history. And I will not begin to tell you about my own civil rights activity, because every man sitting up here knows all about it. But what I'm interested is you understanding why we have black, predominantly black conferences. They are legitimate. Why? Because freedom of worship is a Christian privilege. And you can go to any... Look, if you want to go worship with the Hispanics and you don't even understand Spanish, go! But be sure they are worshiping on the Sabbath.
Yeah.
And they don't yog me. And they get rid of certain adornments. Now... I want that in the record. Now, I'm going to shut up again, but I will be back. We organized these conferences in 44. My legitimacy lies in the fact that I worked for 3 years under white administrator. I am the only Negro sitting up here that did. When you ask me about regional conference, I'm talking about heaven compared with purgatory. The 3 years that I was under the white conferences, we had one black man in the organization who was without power. And he spent most of his time checking on us and reporting on us to the white folks. It was the condition of his staying there. Did you hear me? The next time you get to fussing about your president and these black presidents, call me. Wait, I haven't said a word in a long time, so you stay out of my way. Wait. Come on, folks, you're killing time. You're killing time. You need to learn something. I lived for 3 years under the system. I operated in only holy tents. You heard of the holiness church? I was, and all of the evangelists, John G. Thomas, John Green, these old timers, J.H. Lodge. These are the Negroes that suffered under that system where we only got hand-me-downs to run evangelistic meetings in. I put it like this. All of my tents were holy. And that's not spelled like you are spelling. When I would turn the lights out and Jesus would be in the Garden of Gethsemane, you didn't know that, did you? It was raining. He's in there praying. That's what it looked like, because the rain was coming into my tent and it would go down past the stereopticon that showed the pictures, and the raindrops fell on the pictures, on the screen. Honey, it was holy. The first new tent I got was under a black president. I got brand new chairs, brand new equipment. Emancipation, honey. And it ain't funny. We were even paid a dual salary system. A white man got more money per month than a black man got. And you got the nerve to want to get rid of regional conferences? We ain't going back. I tell you, like Ralph Abernathy said, we ain't going back. Now, I'm going to shut up after this, and I'm going to be a good boy like I've been all, you know, and just sit up here and look sanctified.
And holy. And holy.
Let me close with where I was last Sabbath. I was sitting at a table where there were some of my friends who had immigrated to America from the Caribbean, the island nations of the Caribbean, of the South Atlantic and the nations of the Caribbean, and black like me, who couldn't understand these colored conferences. Now, they made a mistake. The problem is they were talking to me. No, you don't know what I mean. Shut up and listen. I have been everywhere. So I had been all through the Caribbean, where they speak real English as compared with some of our English, and I'd worshiped with everybody, and these people made the mistake of saying, I don't understand. Why are we not all together in the same, under the same roof? Where I came from, we don't have, I don't know what segregation is. What they said after this Negro. I took their appetite. I said, you'd forget to whom you are speaking. I spent so much time down in the South Atlantic and in South America. Let me tell you what you had. The truth was brought down there by white people, so you can't hate white. Now hold it, don't clap, don't do nothing. Let me have my way, and I'm gonna shut up and be a good boy like I've been while these brothers were taking me through history. Let me tell you something. I said, when I went to Trinidad, Port of Spain, there was a white man by the name of Fulfa, a German, who was in charge of the work. White missionaries controlled all of the affairs of everything south of America for years. But that year, the people in Trinidad elected Ralph Thompson as the president of the Caribbean Union. And he be black like me. Wait a minute. They kicked Fulfa out, and he landed the German, and he landed in Haiti. Come on, why did it get so quiet in here? We got some Haitians and some other wonderful people in here. I'm gonna teach you a lesson. You come up here and see black men controlling conferences. Oh, why don't we have? We don't have anything that you don't have. Every white every white executive south of Miami is gone. The only people you've got down, and don't mess with Willie and them, because they don't know. They just learning. I know us. You ran them all out. And the only people operating in Jamaica, in Grenada, in St. Lucia, in Haiti, are professionals. I got to help you. They are professionals. And you come up here and wonder, why do we have to have regional conferences? Why aren't we all together? The whole thing is regional down there.
Yes, sir.
See, now you can fool Willie. You can fool your president. Let me say it like I'm saying it, because I'm trying to help you, son. You ought to know what I'm doing. So shut up and listen. Now you come up here. I don't know. Why are we segregated? The whole outfit down south is black. And in Mexico, the Hispanics are running their own work. You said, oh, but we're making mistakes. They making them too. And the white folks make some real expensive mistakes. I ought to know, because I operated in the big house for 23 years. There's a lot in my head that I will not tell you. All I want to tell you is respect these men.
Amen.
You'll hear from me again before I'm through.
Mylas.
What you don't know is this. Before 1950, no black people were admitted to Southwest University now.
Yes, University College.
No black Americans were admitted to what is today Southern University. There were no black Americans admitted to what is today Columbia Union College. And all of the others that did admit black Americans had a quota. As a matter of fact, I was accepted at Old Emmanuel Missionary College because the registrar wrote me a letter. I wrote saying, I'm at the university and I would like to come to Emmanuel Missionary College in September. She said, Mr. Martin, why wait? Come in January, just fill out this application blank. I filled it out. It required a picture. They accepted me. They accepted me thinking I was white because of the grades. When the picture arrived, they saw that I was anything but white, and they refused to admit me. Now, I can tell you, we all can tell you stories, but the simple fact of the matter is this. We've got a long way, we've come a long way in this society, but we've come from a lot.
That's right.
Stony the road we trod.
Right.
And I can tell you, not many Adventists know the name Billie Holiday, but she said something very wise. Papa may have, Mama may have, but God bless the child who's got his own. Now you're going to hear a layman quote scripture with a bunch of preachers sitting on either side of him. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, but there are varieties of gifts and differences of administration. So there's nothing wrong with different local conferences. And regional conferences are simply local conferences that are black administered.
Yes.
Black administered. I would be happy to see the Hispanics have theirs, The Asians have theirs because there are differences of administration. And you know what happens when you let a little group get their own? They start winning souls. They start winning souls, and Koreans have been joining regional conferences simply because, and they would leave the other conferences and join regional conferences because they know that regional conferences have one goal above all others, evangelism. And the major part of the budget goes for evangelism. I am thinking of one church in one local conference. They're a wealthy church, 3,200 members, and 5 years ago their church budget for the church alone was $500,000. And they had an appropriation for evangelism. Guess how much it was? $1,500. Out of $500,000, $1,500 for evangelism. We believe in evangelism. That is one difference. Color is not the main difference. The belief in evangelism, sir, that is the main difference. Let me tell you something that I checked last night because I thought, Elder McCoy, I had written it myself for your publication. But I checked the figures. Between 1985 and 2000, the nine regional conferences gave in tithes and offerings to the World Church $1
billion. With a B.
With a B. $1,011,000,000+. Now, before I leave here, I am going to print it out, if I can get someone with a printer, so that you can each have a copy. You're here. I want you to see the figures.
As a matter of fact, that figure, as it stands, is only exceeded by the North American division
itself. In other words, regional conferences in their financial contributions to this church are exceeded only by the North American division, of which they are an essential part.
Yes. Let me just say, because you gave a period of time.
Yes, sir.
But over like last year, if you look at just the records from recent years, in one single year, North American Vision will have like 700 and three-quarters of $1 billion. Regional conference's goal, their tithe, was almost $150 million for the 1 year, for that same period. And that means that out of all divisions around the world, the regional conferences give more to this church than any other division except the North American division.
And on the issue of support, because I think this is a critical issue so that people understand what the role of regional conferences has been. Elder McCoy.
Yeah, and we did a study just a couple of years ago, and I'm sure it is still true, that the percentage of the tithe that comes from regional conferences that go to the general conference was equal to the amount of money that the general conference used to send to support the world field. So that the percentage of tithe that came from our conferences was great enough to support what the general conference gives to the rest of the world.
And in addition to that, of course, before Dr. Miles speaks, they are the missionaries we send out. They are the support systems that this church, meaning the regional conferences, provide. Dr. Miles, did you have a point?
And I just want to tie in with what Brother Martin and Elder Cleveland have said. One of the things, one of the geniuses of the regional conferences is the fact that regional conferences have been the greatest missionary impulse to the urban communities of North America. We're, in fact, the only folks who are in the cities winning people right now. There is no state conference that has a significant ministerial presence in the large cities. Regional conferences today are the only people in the big cities of our country reaching people. If you go to come to the city of Chicago where I live, And I share that city with the Illinois Conference. And there is no Illinois Conference church of any size within the city limits of Chicago, save one, and it is mostly Filipino and Hispanic. The only large church in the Chicago area is out in Hinsdale, which is a very wealthy suburb, and we have a hospital there. But the Lake Region Conference has about 12 churches, some of them very sizable, in the city of Chicago. The same is true in the Allegheny East Conference. The same is true in Northeastern Conference. The fact of the matter is regional conferences represent the church's reach to city people. And that is why we're not only winning black people, but when I became president of Lake Region Conference in 1995, we had four Hispanic churches. We now have 25 Hispanic churches within our conference. When I became president, we had no Korean churches. We now have three. We had no African churches. We now have four. And so what's happening is many of these groups, most of which are in large urban areas, are gravitating to regional conferences because, as Brother Martin has said, regional conferences believe in evangelism, and number two, because we have always been interested in working where the people are, while our other brethren in state conferences are much more interested in working in small towns, in small communities, or around institutions. Our major churches are in cities. The major churches of our other conference brethren are around hospitals or schools.
Institutions.
Dr. Brooks.
I think it's important to add this. We are hearing about progress, and a date was given, 1985, I believe. We need to understand that the legitimacy of the black or regional conference in terms of progress didn't begin then. I remember studying this out a long time ago. In 20 years after the conferences were allowed, in 20 years, we had quadrupled our funds, quadrupled our membership, and quadrupled our ministerial worker force. That spells success.
Yes, sir.
You don't kill a thing that's working.
Yes, sir.
And to the glory of God, He has blessed. And I really get upset when people suggest that a regional conference means that black folk are somehow prejudiced against their white brethren. That isn't so. The Lord's servant told us to work for our own people, and I like that. And that's what we do. But we come together at the main table, and we have a seat there.
Yes, sir.
Now because of these figures you're hearing up here. I remember meeting one of our great leaders in the park one day. We were walking, my wife and I were going, and he and his wife, and we stopped to chat. And he said, "Charles, I really believe we ought to give up the black conferences." I said, "Well, what do you mean by that?" I knew what he meant. He meant that all of our presidents should resign and turn administration over to a Caucasian conference. I said, "I'll tell you what I'll do. I'll go along with you if you will put Chesapeake in the hands of Alvin Kibble and the Allegheny East Conference."
Yes, sir.
"And if you go down south and you take Alabama, Mississippi, and turn it over to Joe McCoy and the people down there." That ended the conversation. This business of integration, the way they explain it, is not integration at all. It's annihilation of our impetus as a people in this church.
Yes. If Ellen McCoy.
If I may.
Yes.
I've grown up Seventh Day.
Yes.
My mother, my grandmother,
yeah.
Seventh Day. I'm offended when somebody comes up to me and try to use regional conferences as a symbol of segregation.
Right.
I submit to you that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is more integrated organizationally and structurally than these other denominations. There are predominantly black Baptist organizations, not predominantly, exclusively Methodists, And I could go on. When you come to the Seventh-day Adventist Church, regional conferences are local conferences. All local conferences belong to a union. And all unions belong to a division of the General Conference. All of our conferences belong to a union and a division of the General Conference. So there is no difference. When the Southern Union meets, we are all there. All black of us are there, all of us. The whites and the blacks are there for a union meeting. When the North American Division meets, we are all there. We are not trying to find a way to go to work together, as are the Southern Baptists and the National Baptists. They're trying to find a way to work together. We already work together because we already belong to the same church. Organizationally, structurally. Now, are you going to and you're going to find a predominant something anywhere in the world. So the fact that regional conferences exist is not a symbol of segregation. I think it is a signal of agenda.
Amen.
I'm going to join Elder Cleveland in a few moments. He's been very silent. I'm going to be silent too. But I'd like to do two things.
It's a temporary silence.
I understand that. I well understand that. I'd like you to understand something. I was in New York as a newspaper reporter. For one of the seven papers there, I was with a very great newspaper. In the 1960s, I covered the Astors, the Vanderbilts, the Whitneys, Robert Kennedy, all of the celebrities of that day I covered. But I learned something when the civil rights movement started. We had a great debate in the city room there, Elder Brooks. What word were we going to use to explain what the civil rights movement was about? Now, I contended that the civil rights movement was about desegregation, and that there is a difference between desegregation and integration. Desegregation simply means that you as a citizen have the right to go wherever you want, be there like anyone else, and you also have the responsibilities that are carried by citizens. As it has worked out, integration has meant a very delicate balance. A few of you here, some of you there, but not too many of you anywhere. That's the way it has worked out.
That's right.
And we see that in our own organization. Remember, a few of you here, some of you there, but not too many of you anywhere. That is integration, and that's the way it has worked out. Now, I'd like to read something because we're starting the first of a series here tonight.
Right.
Is that right, Elder?
That's right.
We're going to have panels. We're going to have conversations.
Right.
We're going to explain to you the church organization. Many of you think the church manual governs the church. There is an 800-page something called what? Working policy, General Conference Working Policy. You need to understand how the church is governed. We're going to talk about the organization. You know the belief system, but you need to understand how the organization works. And let me tell you, the first lesson is that without structure, meaning without a local conference structure, you have no voice. You have no decision-making ability. What we have, some of us who are as old as Elder Brooks, are determined that we're not going to give it up because it took us too long to get it. And we remember how it was before. I remember when my application came back from old EMC, the first thing that dropped out was the non-refundable fee for checking my grades. That's the way it used to be. And one of these times we're going to talk about the current white flight. I believe that whites and Asians and Chinese and everybody else, it's called the right of association. If I want to surround myself only with pretty folk, I have a right to do that. And so have you. But now, let me tell you this. We've talked about the past because of this. Without the past, there can be no future. Without an exact knowledge of the past, there can be no meaningful, directed, and strategic engaging of the future. The NAD regional conferences have a mission such as every other conference in the North American division, but we have an added mission, Dr. Mylas. The regional conferences engage both in the gospel ministry and in the great unfinished social task, that of lifting all Black Americans from second-class status into the full responsibilities and privileges of participatory American citizenship. That's our task. Just because some of us have made it, that does not mean that we forget those who have not made it.
In fact, on that point, I want to get back, because this is now going to be the next point. What is the challenge for the next 10, 15 years if the Lord delays his return? But before we do that, we have Nolette Leader Hutton, who is going to come and sing us into this next and hopefully last segment.
We have two silent ones here.
Not for long.
Praise the Lord, everybody. Let me get this mic on. 1, 2, 3.
Somewhere over the rainbow way up high, there's a land God has promised. We'll him by and by. When the morning comes, a better day after a while there will. Better day, yes, hallelujah. A better day, my child. God has promised us a better day in a little while. For a lifetime of smiles. And Elder Cleveland, I'll forget how hard it's been to run these last few miles. And when Jesus says to me, welcome home, my child, they'll surely be worthwhile. A better day after a while there will be. A better day, yes. A better day, my child. God has promised us a better day in a little while. Someday we'll meet him in the sky, with no tomorrows, no goodbyes, in glory. We'll be free.
sorrow, free from sin. God's angels, they'll be listening in to hear my story. A better day, there's gonna be, there's gonna be a better day, a better day, my child. God has promised us a better day, so hold on, don't you give up.
You know, our problem is that we have sitting here so much knowledge, so much information, that all we have done now is just to tickle. Elder Taylor, you have to promise to do this again.
By all means, Southeastern, would you like to continue this, Doc?
Mark.
The boss.
Yes, El.
There is something that I think ought to be said, and
yes,
to be said quickly. A minority can never affect anything important without the help of many in the majority group. All of our brethren have not been hard against us. All
yes.
are not ogres. As a matter of fact, there's one that comes to my mind because of personal experience,
yes.
who exemplary, and that was Elder Neil C. Wilson.
Yes, sir.
I have never met any man quite like him. He was aggressive. He insisted. His own brethren thought he was playing politics. I never will forget his answer when he said, a real politician never appeals to the minority, but rather to the majority. He said, the difference is that I sleep at night and you can't. This man was unrelenting in pursuit of justice for all of us.
Yeah.
He meant it. He cared about our interests. Elder Neil C. Wilson, just one of many who joined us, helped us to accomplish a great deal.
Let's get Elder McCoy and then you.
Well, what I wanted to say on that score, and I appreciate the Elder bringing that point out, but I think it underscores something in the American society and in the Seventh-day Adventist Church that we overlook.
Right.
The majority of the people in our country and in our church want to do the right thing.
Yes, sir.
And that is the reason. If the majority of our people wanted to do the wrong thing, we never would have been able to accomplish
yes.
what we have been able to accomplish.
Amen.
Every white person, everything in America may not be racist, but it is racial.
Yes.
And we have to remember that. The other thing is there are two absolutes about negative people. Two. They're always the fewest, and they're always the loudest. And let's remember that the quiet people, what Richard Nixon called them, the silent majority. I hate to quote Richard Nixon, but he did say it. He went after the silent majority. And in this country, we talk about the founding fathers.
Yes.
But it's the founding principles
yes.
that drove them.
Yes.
And those are Christian-based principles.
Yes.
So that all of us who call ourselves Christians are bound to do the right thing for the right reason.
In a few moments, we have left.
I'd like to tell you something
yes.
that Joseph McCoy said. He said, a black leader is someone who changes things black people need to change. I'd like you to think about that. The point that we've been talking about this evening is that you have clergy and laity who have been engaged over the past 61 years that I know of in what I call loyal insurgency. Loyal insurgency. He hits on me all the time. But we need to understand that God has given us something in this structure, and we need to work at what God has given to us. Now, if you invite me again, Elder Taylor, if I may come again, I may tell you about the Southern abolitionists who were on our side. There was one in Huntsville, Alabama. His name was James G. Birney. He freed all of his slaves and moved north and became an abolitionist. There were two sisters in South Carolina, Sarah and Angelina Grimke. You don't know who your friends have been.
Yes.
If I come back, I'll tell you who they were, and I'll tell you who they weren't. Because some of us, if Abraham Lincoln and Thomas Jefferson had had their way, would still be picking cotton.
How about that? Now, for the next few minutes, you know, while you were talking, Elder Cleveland said he's been quiet long enough. And so rather than invoke fury from someone who's been silent, let's hear from him.
There are two things that I want to say. Civil rights operators within the Adventist Church and outside have been accused of hatred, that hatred is the motivational force. You just don't like white people. If you protest their policies, I've got news for you. I was put into the Seventh-day Adventist Church, and I'm going to tell you this because you need to know, as the church's experiment in departmental integration, I was the Jackie Robinson. There was not a black person in a department of the General Conference. No, not one. When they shoved me in there, nobody knew what my duties were, either the shovers or the shovee. So I bring a perspective to this discussion that nobody else can bring. I was on my own and alone. The first day in office, I decided to go down to talk to my department head as to what my responsibilities were. I see you leaning forward, so I knew you would be interested in this. When I got to the door was cracked, and all of the white inductees were discussing me. See? I decided, rather than go in, I would learn what they were thinking about this black man suddenly being interposed into their white society. The department head was saying, as I stood there, well, we have Earl here. I don't know what we're going to do with him. He just graduated Oakwood College. And he, what does he know about editing articles for publication in our world-class magazine, The Ministry? I tiptoed back to my office, locked the door, and did the T.D. Jakes dance. I said, free at last. They don't know what to do with me, and for the next 23 years, I did my own thing. Now, I wanted to tell you something of what that involved and let you go. It takes 3 minutes. Since I was the tip of the arrow, and there was none with me, because I was up there by myself, these presidents couldn't tell me what to do or how. They just shoved me in there. So the first thing I did, and this is the story, and there are hundreds of them, I decided to integrate the office of the General Conference. I sat me down and wrote 16 names. Went downstairs to the one black recording secretary in the building out of 198 secretaries. One black. And she was in the regional department. Her name was Evelyn Mays, in case you think I'm making up the story. She's still alive. I went down there. I said, Evelyn. She said, yeah. I said, in 15 minutes, somebody's going to call you and ask you to do my secretarial work. If this is integration, it's got to be integration, honey. There are four staff secretaries in the department where I was put. But I knew what would happen. I said, now this will be your speech. Ah, Elder Blank, and I won't call his name out of respect. I already worked for two men, Elder Peterson and Elder Mosley. I can't take anything else on. I said, repeat that. And she did. I said, you'll get the call in 15 minutes to be my secretary. You say what I told you to say. And I went back, called the boss, and said, I've got 16 letters to dictate. I hadn't dictated a letter in my life. I was a new dictator. I said, y'all don't know half the story, honey. Amen. So when I went back, I called the head of the department. I said, this is Earl, your new staff elected person. I need secretarial help. I've got 16 letters to dictate. Coming right up, Earl. Hung up. Called that one Negro out of 100 and some secretary and said, we have Earl present. I thought I'd bring you down to earth before the benediction. We've got Earl here, and he needs the secretarial help. Oh, Elder Blank, I already work for two Negroes, Elder Peterson and Elder Mosley. I can't take on anything else. Now defat was in defiant. Give the man credit. He called the four secretaries that were already in the staff, on the staff, and said, Earl is here. He needs secretarial help. One of you will serve him. If you don't, you will never again work one day in the General Conference. Now, you may volunteer. Oh, I got a heap of bedtime stories, but I can't tell but this one. You may volunteer. I will appoint one of you. Now, y'all down there opening your cans of gluten and ain't thinking about me. And I have been cast upon a sea of white, and I ain't white. This tells you the problem. Goes to the heart of it. She said, I can't do it. And he hung up and called those white secretaries there and said, one of you will work for Earl. You may volunteer, or I will appoint you. If you refuse, you are through in this building. Now, I was 32 years old. And you know what most white folk think, the Negroes who have secretaries working around them. They don't trust us because of our skin. They didn't know that I was one of the most happily married men on the face of the earth and married to a woman prettier than anything they had on the staff. Yeah. You understand me? I thought you'd like this bedtime story to close this thing. So the little British girl, 27-year-old, said, I'll work for Elder Cleveland. Now that was like Chicken Little, man. The sky was about to fall in. Never in the history of Adventism had a black man had a white, a black man with a white boss. Not in the earth. And I'm sitting in there making my way. In conclusion, let me tell you what happened. The next morning, he appeared at my office. By the way, the windows were cloudy in those days. You couldn't stand out in the hall and look in there and see what's going on in the office. I had him over the barrel, boy. I'm waiting on my secretary. He opens the door, this little blonde British girl standing there, and give the man credit. He said, Earl, Doreen is your secretary. Doreen, Earl is your boss. I looked at that sister. I said, you're married, aren't you? She said, yes. I said, so am I. Go over there and sit in that chair opposite my desk. She did it. Anderson was still standing at the door when I got back in a state of shock. The boss. I said, would you like to come in? He said, no, Earl, I'm busy. So I shut the door in he face. In conclusion, mister, the sky did not cave in. The girl worked for me for 8 years, and they gave me white secretaries until I left the place, and everybody that came in after me got a white secretary. So Brother Fordham and some of us got together and said, we got to reverse this thing. And so we got them to hire black secretaries, the white elected secretary. Just one of the problems that goes with integration, whatever that is. Thank you.
Well, we've taken the folks through all this. What lies next, Ella Brooks?
The finishing of the work. Priorities, concentrating on what's really important.
Yes.
Conference leadership in these regional conferences is supposed to provide the vision. Yes. And all the rest of us had better rally to the cause of the Lord and let's get out of here. Our message is an evacuation message. We are facing things this world has never seen before. It's time for the Lord to come. Let's do what we can to facilitate that great eventuality.
Now, Ella Brooks, I want to ask these younger leaders, Elder McCoy, Elder Miles, and Elder Taylor. And now, what's interesting, especially about Elder McCoy and Elder Taylor, is that most of the regional conference presidents have tended to be, for some reason, former directors of youth departments. How did that come about? And what is it you have to say about finishing the work? We'll start with Elder McCoy and Elder Taylor.
Well, I wish that you had started with Elder Taylor since he's the youngest. And that's good news to him.
Yes.
I really don't know, in fact, how that happened. One thing I suspect is when you're the youth director, you have a constituency. And you get these kids at 15, 16 years old, and in 5 years, 8 years, they're grown. And they remember all of the wonderful things you did for them while they were young people. So that these young people begin to lead out in churches. Churches have delegates that they send to conference sessions. And when these young people get there, they vote for who they know. And it just so happens that all of us, almost all of us at one time had come out of youth ministry. And I think that's one of the contributing factors. And of course, you have to just take the Lord out of it to deal with that, the political side of it. But for sure, I think that's one of the contributing factors, is that our constituency grew old with us,
yes.
Or should I say matured with us, and were there to vote when it was time to choose a conference leader.
I'm going to just back up a little bit to talk about the role, a little of the role of the black youth leadership. There's one thing that the church has feared since we first landed here, and that is that we would talk to one another, that we would organize, and it's that organization. And that's why they said they, whenever they saw us congregating and we weren't singing, you know, then they didn't want us to be talking, because there could be a plan. And of course, there were many, many plans that came out of our singing that were disguised. So that was a beautiful thing. But it was that organization. And when I became youth director and I followed, I was coming in on Joe's, Bella McCoy's, yes. And some of the others, we decided that we wanted to organize formally. And when we did, we called ourselves the Black Adventist Youth Directors Association. And that's BETA, the acronym for BETA. And BETA has done some wonderful things. Because when you organize in this church, the church has to recognize you. And we weren't really getting that North American division recognition. Really, we were fighting, and they were pointing the finger at us, in some cases, rightly so, but we had to lead our youth. But when we organized, we were able now to get our agenda and our schedule on the division calendar. And that made us, as youth directors, a part of the system. And I might just say here right now that the youth federations, way back in the 60s when the other side of the house began to change and make AY meetings or MV meetings at that time on Friday nights, you know, we were buffeted by that because when they changed the time for the sun to go down for these long afternoons, then, you know, we knew we wouldn't have much to, any control over our young people when the sun set at 8 o'clock and 8:30, and you know, you were not having AY on Sabbath afternoon. So we kept the AY system going on Sabbath afternoon, and it helped to keep our young people together. During those years when they were saying X number of youth are leaving the church, they weren't black youth.
That's right.
The black youth were staying in the church because BETA, the youth directors, were providing activities for them to do. And so I think the same way, I'm not sure why so many youth directors, and this is church-wide, it's not just in the regional conferences, but many white presidents have been former youth directors also. So it is a church-wide phenomenon. But I would say this, that we kept the federations going. And the federations were a marvelous, enviable structure to the church at large. How do you get so many people together and they have fun? Well, of course, we had been kept apart so long over our history in this country. We just love the fellowship. As a matter of fact, they sing the song, "What a Fellowship." And so we love to come together and fellowship. And so right now, as we speak, our Black North American Division Youth Director is planning a church-supported youth federation, a youth congress for the division. And it's because we have a young man who came up as a youth director in the regional conference, who's now in that position, who is going to be a benefit to all races and all cultures because they all will be invited to this youth congress.
There's another value to the youth federations, AY societies. When a lot of young people were leaving the church, the other conferences were operating under the delusion that all their kids were at the academy. But when I looked at the enrollment at these academies, all of the young people in the Seventh-day Adventist Church could not have been in those academies. But our persistence with the youth programs, the federations, the AY Sabbath afternoon, when our parents could not send their children to church school because of economics, they could send them to church on the weekends and have a heavy dose of what Adventists were supposed to be at the Adventist youth meeting. It was MV once upon a time, and it got to be AY. But the strong youth program, church-based, was able to keep our young people in the church, especially among those who could not afford to go to the church school.
Amen. And before you speak, Dr. Mylas, I want you to think about this, Mr. Martin, about where we go from here in terms of evangelism? Because it seems what you're talking about is an aspect of evangelism. And as you've looked at church growth over the years, think about sharing your insight about what we do for the few years that remain, if, as we all pray, the Lord's coming is near. Dr. Mylas.
Well, I want to make a comment relative to something Elder McCoy said and then answer your question or make an attempt at it.
Right.
In 1985 at Andrews University, we did a piece of research, and it was just limited to the Lake Union, but it could be replicated in other unions as well. Right. Five conferences in Lake Union. There is the regional conference, Lake Region, Indiana, Michigan, Illinois, and Wisconsin. And they surveyed the churches in every conference. And any church that had any youth program, just one, it was counted. Whether it's Pathfinders, Adventurers, AYF, if it had any kind of youth program at all, it was counted. At the end of the day, we discovered that the Michigan Conference, oldest conference in the United States, had 51% of its churches had some kind of youth programming, which meant 49% didn't. In the Illinois Conference, 38% of its churches had some kind of youth programming. In the Illinois Conference, 23% of its churches had some kind of youth programming. In the Indiana Conference, 18% of its churches had some kind of youth programming. In the Lake Region Conference, 99% of its churches had some kind of youth programming.
Wow.
That's a regional conference.
That's the regional conference. The same could be said in every conference, in every union in the United States. Regional conferences have kept the youth work alive. Now, I mention that because that's the way to answer your question. Yeah. Our priorities for the future have got to be in working with people. We have a large generation of people now that have not been raised in a religious environment. Years and years ago, we used to put up a tent, and people would come out of curiosity, and usually they'd know the songs we sang and so forth. I taught a religion class at the University of Michigan for 26 years as an adjunct professor, usually about 200 kids per class. One of the things that I found interesting was that many of these young people, and many of them African-American young people, had never been to church on a regular basis. When I was growing up, you could hardly find a black kid who didn't go to somebody's church. But a lot of our young people, a lot of our best and brightest young people, don't go to church. They've not been reared like that. They've been reared by parents who said, well, my mom and daddy made me go to church, so I'm gonna let my kids decide what they're gonna do. And of course, you're gonna choose between the cartoons and going to church. Well, the kid's gonna choose the cartoons and television. And what has happened is we now have a large percentage of our black young people who are pagan. They're not bad, but they're pagan. They have no religious constructs at all, but they're looking for something. And I'm finding in my own ministry that if you speak to them, and you speak to them in the love of Christ, that they accept it and they soak it up like a sponge, and it's easier to get them to change and do right than the old folks. And that is our future, the future of reaching these millions of young people who have a lot to offer, who God has given great wisdom to. We got to rescue them, because a large percentage of our African-American males and our Hispanic males are going to prison.
Yes.
And if we don't get them, the jail will.
Yeah. Elder Martin and Pastor Brooks, and then we'll have Elder Taylor close, and then we'll have music from Moses Samuel Brown.
I will answer this way. That which we do best, we need to continue to do. We have been assigned to take the gospel into all the world. We need to focus upon that, because all that we do not do for Christ will perish. All that we do for Christ will endure. But I go back to my idea that black Seventh-day Adventists have a dual mission. And I would remind you that a man was walking in 1846 along a dry creek bed. He saw a very large rock. He picked it up and took it home and for 3 years used it as a doorstop. Then someone said to him one day, I'll buy that. I'll pay you $12 for it. He said, it's yours. It turned out to be solid gold. Mm. And that is how the gold rush started in 1849. A man picked up something, had it, and didn't realize its value. We have a message. We have an organization. We have leadership. We have wonderful young people. Let's value what we have and do the Lord's work. I say to you, the United States, the world, is looking for you simply because, pastors and laity, you have, gentlemen, created what I term a culture of black success. A culture of black success. Our young people are competitive, and we'll talk about that next time.
Ella Brooks.
I think that I ought to add that much of our problem is caused by our abandonment of our message and the mandate that God has given to us. Mm. He has told us specifically what he wants us to do. We'd better get back to it. Amen. I'd like to add one other thought to that, and that is, I do not buy the idea that if you tell the truth from the pulpit, you're going to drive young people away. I have pastored large churches. I have pastored young people. My young people came on Wednesday nights. Amen. They did everything the grown-ups did. Amen. And when we got ready for the long campaign in the middle of the summer, I used to tell my church, we are going to have a moratorium on socials and picnics and all that sort of thing. And our young people took part in that. You're talking about audacity. I used to tell my folks, I don't even want you to die during this campaign. You know what? They didn't die. And when we had prayer meeting, the young people were there, and they passed out the handbills, and they brought people to Christ. We'd better rediscover what our business is and involve everybody in it, and let's get the work finished.
Before you give us, I just want to let you know that we got Elder, we got Moses Brown and Gail Murphy, who has waited patiently to sing us out. And Dr. Cleveland promises me that he has 2 minutes, and that if not, we will do something to the microphone. Go
ahead. I won't tempt you to do that and sin. Let me tell you people something. When I came through North Carolina, all the Carolinas, the youth of my church were my primary interests. I had them on the radio. Charles Brooks used to sing in my radio choir, and young people hung around the church like bees, flies hung around honey. I could not let this thing close without you knowing that young people and I have been together a long time. It is a key to some of these elections. These men that give so much attention to young people reap the reward at election time. I believe.